Ihr solltet die Männer...
Fika Fletcher sorgt dafür, dass die Männer sich an Deck versammeln. Und zwar alle Mann.
Aber
später.
Master Drake, ihr hättet ihnen schon längst die Wahrheit sagen sollen.
Ach ja?
Master Doughty,
ihr habt selbst viel Geld in diese Unternehmung investiert. Ohne äußerste Geheimhaltung wäre es von Anfang an zum Scheitern verurteilt gewesen.
Master Drake, Ihre Majestät, die Königin hat uns beauftragt.
Hat mich beauftragt. Und jetzt entschuldigt mich, Master Doughty.
Century London. The English capital is jostling for its position as world power. It is the time of the Tudors and of Shakespeare. And the Protestant Queen Elizabeth. Europe is split by the Counter-Reformation, a bitter struggle between Catholics and Protestants. For the powerful Catholic countries in Europe, Elizabeth is a bastard queen on the English throne, born from the whore Anne Boleyn. The Catholics want to force Elizabeth from the throne and revert England to Catholicism. The deeply Catholic Spain is a constant and serious threat. Elizabeth needs soldiers, but they're expensive, and the treasury is running low. The Queen is intent on finding a way to the treasures of the New World without triggering a war with the powerful Spanish kingdom.
Die Spanier sitzen in der neuen Welt wie die Heuschrecken auf den Feldern. Fett und satt. Die einzige Gefahr für ihre Schiffe ist das Gewicht des geladenen Goldes.
Majestät, wir müssen neue Wege finden, um an den Reichtümern dieser neuen Welt teilzuhaben. Sie liegen vor uns. Wir brauchen sie nur zu pflücken.
In the 16th century, Protestant England is weakening in the face of the powerful Spain and Portugal. The Catholic kingdoms have carved out the New World between themselves. The Portuguese control the trade routes from Asia all the way to the Spice Islands. The Spaniards are plundering the riches of the New World. Even the trade routes to Europe are blocked. The important merchant ports of Antwerp and Bruges are part of the Spanish Netherlands, and Protestants are not welcome traders here.
Große Teile der neuen Welt warten nur darauf, im Namen eurer Majestät in Besitz genommen zu werden.
Wir haben uns erlaubt, das Vorhaben auf wenigen Seiten zusammenzufassen.
The real document presented to Elizabeth by Walsingham. It's sadly been burnt by fire, but we can still see interesting items like the pole, the South Sea, then as far northwards along the said coast. By this we can understand that Drake was meant to sail south through the Straits of Magellan and then as far north 30 degrees where the modern day coast of Chile was unoccupied by the Spanish. It says he was aiming to find a place that was under the obedience of no princes and hopefully to find spices, drugs and special commodities that might help Her Highness's dominions. This shows that this voyage was not just a merchant trading voyage. He was out for discovery. He was out looking for ways to future the Elizabethan kingdom.
Der Befehlshaber dieser Unternehmung hat sich schon als junger Mann auf Fahrten in die neue Welt einen Namen gemacht. Seine Männer achten ihn und die Spanier fürchten ihn. Aus seinen Kaperfahrten in die neue Welt. Und er ist bereit, auch selbst einen ganz erheblichen Betrag zu investieren. Darf ich vorstellen?
Majestät.
Francis Drake, Kapitän und treuer Diener Ihrer Majestät.
Dieses Treffen hat nie stattgefunden.
Although London is an important trading port, the voyage is to set off from Plymouth, in Devon on the southwestern tip of England. This is where the ships that the merchant adventurers used were built and kitted out. They set out to sea to find trade and goods in the New World.
Here, in the Elizabethan Gardens in Plymouth, and in the adjoining streets, you can really get a sense of Drake's 16th century Plymouth. The overhanging jetties, typical of the Tudor buildings of the time, and the narrow streets that would have been teeming with merchants, tradesmen, residents and visitors of all around the world. Plymouth was expanding because of Britain's international trade. Drake, though born just 15 miles away from here, learnt his trade in Kent, but he returned to Plymouth to reconnect with his kinsmen, the Hawkins, and begin his journey of fame and fortune.
He was soon captain of his own ship, and his adventurous escapades into the New World had made him a rich man. Drake repeatedly sailed to the West Indian Islands, as the Caribbean was known at the time. But the privateer needed a new challenge.
So this fantastic volume is one of our most prized possessions here at the Plymouth and West Devon Record Office. It's what we call the Ptolemy Atlas. It was printed 500 years ago in 1513 in Strasbourg. And we think that it was taken by Sir Francis Drake on his circumnavigation of the globe between 1577 and 1580. And the reason we think that is because it was found at his family home of Buckland Abbey some years ago. So a book of this type, there would only have been very limited amounts printed. It would have been very expensive, and only somebody with a reasonable amount of wealth and income would be able to purchase something like this. And it's got representations of what was then the known world and quite a lot of what was unknown at that time, which in this volume is called Terra Incognita, which literally is land unknown. So very exciting. Drake is setting out on a journey to a place that he had no idea about.
Drake convinces the Queen. Combining funds with other investors, they prepare five vessels. Drake's flagship is the Pelican. During this voyage, he is to give her the name under which she would become known to the world, the Golden Hind. The fleet's chaplain is Reverend Francis Fletcher. His diary documents the entire journey.
Diese Schiffe bemannte Drake mit 164 fähigen und tauglichen Männern und stattete sie auch mit einem reichlichen Vorrat aller notwendigen Dinge aus, die eine so lange und gefährliche Reise erforderte. Auch hatte er nicht versäumt, für Ausschmückung und Vergnügen zu sorgen. Zu diesem Zweck führte er ausgezeichnete Musikanten mit sich und die verschiedensten Paradestücke einer zierlichen Handwerkskunst, an denen die Kultur und Größe seines Heimatlandes von allen Völkern, zu denen er gelangen sollte, gebührend bewundert werden konnte.
On board are members of the English nobility, confidants of the investors. On land, their position and wealth lends them power and influence. The sailors distrust them from the start.
Master Doughty, willkommen an Bord.
Master Drake.
Drake is reliant on his financiers and their sponsors. However, on board, the captain, who has worked his way up the ranks as a commoner and is barely literate, is reluctant to share his power. Not even with his old friend, Thomas Doughty. In 1577, Drake sets sail from Plymouth with 5 ships. Only Drake and his sponsors know the true purpose of the journey. To throw Spanish spies off the scent, it is officially a trade mission to the Mediterranean. Only on the high seas does Drake tell his crew the real destination of their journey. Along the Cape Verde Islands, Drake encounters and seizes the first Portuguese ships. From there, the trade winds blow the fleet towards Brazil. No one knows exactly how long the journey will take. The vessels only have enough food and water to last them several weeks. Drake makes sure he secures the maps and logbooks of the Portuguese, his most valuable booty. A replica of the ship lies anchored in London. With this golden hind, Keith Smeaton sailed in the footsteps of Drake.
I thought it was quite amazing at that particular point. Yeah. So if Elizabethan navigation was done well, it did work, because Drake was successful in his navigation.
But this was his first real adventure further south.
Indeed, yeah.
How would he have gone about finding the information to get him down these coasts that he didn't know?
Well, because the Spanish had gone into South America, and the Portuguese gone to South America, and was taking the Inca gold out. They were very concerned about keeping it secret, because the countries were in competition. So there was very little information in those days. It was trial and error. But Drake knew that Magellan had succeeded, and there must have been some logs or logbooks, some maps that he had drawn. And there is a strong suspicion that Drake actually went down to Lisbon and secretly to try and locate a couple of people on some of these maps.
Of course, the Spanish had huge monopolies at this time. I imagine they would have wanted to keep it under lock and key for their own purposes.
And not only that, they would falsify the map as well. The Spanish would alter the maps completely to mislead potential interlopers like Drake getting hold of this stuff. Because they didn't want interlopers coming in and what they called stealing their gold from their private ocean.
On board the ship, every man counts. There's no place for class divide, as each of the men must do their part.
Master Drake!
The fine Pinkel.
Habt ihr eure Mannschaft nicht im Griff?
Obwohl sie genau wissen, dass Master Drake befohlen hat, dass alle mit anpacken müssen.
Bringt ihnen gefälligst Benehmen bei.
Ich bin mir nicht sicher, wer sich hier nicht zu benehmen weiß.
Sir.
Ich kann mir nicht vorstellen, dass sich der Captain das noch lange bieten lässt.
Doughty thought he was an equal to Drake. And Drake knew that there can only be one leader with one objective. And if you have conflict on a ship, on a small ship like this, with 80 people on board, and there's division of leadership, you're going to end up with mutiny. And Drake could not have allowed that to happen, because the voyage would not succeed.
The tension between the two men grows. Doughty accuses Drake of witchcraft, a common recrimination at the time, and tries to incite the crew. Drake must make an example and enforce discipline with a harsh punishment.
Drake warnte die Mannschaft davor, mit Master Doughty zu sprechen oder sich zu ihm zu gesellen. Täte es jemand, so würde er diesen als seinen Feind betrachten. Ja, mehr noch als Gegner dieser Reise.
Drake knows that mutiny is more dangerous than the deadliest storm or most hostile enemy ships. The most perilous part of the voyage is yet to come, and can only succeed if the crew work together as a team. No European has sailed this far into the frosty and inhospitable southern waters since Ferdinand Magellan. The onset of winter forces the voyage to seek refuge ashore. They take shelter in the Bay of San Julian, just as Magellan did before them.
Cuando Drake llega a la Bahía de San Julián en invierno de 1578, viene aquí con el fin de pasar una temporada, que van a ser dos meses, buscando reparo. Pero en realidad lo que encuentra es un lugar absolutamente desolado, desértico. Esto es la estepa Patagonia, que se funde con el mar austral argentino. Es un lugar con vientos permanentes, vientos normales de 130 a 140 kilómetros por hora. La temperatura, inclusive en primavera, rara vez sube arriba de los 10, 12 grados. Así que las condiciones de estadía de Drake y su tripulación aquí en San Julián fueron verdaderamente difíciles.
But the cove offers protection from the wind and a food source, even if penguin meat is too tough to be really enjoyable. Now they can but wait. There's nothing but time for the conflict between Drake and his critics to play out.
Una cuestión, creo yo, culturalmente muy importante es que Drake era un plebeyo, era una persona que venía de lo más bajo de los estratos sociales, mientras tanto Doughty y otros oficiales eran personas de alcurnia, pertenecían a la nobleza británica, tenían contactos políticos con la corona británica, de modo tal que Drake era considerado algo así como un advenedizo, mientras que los nobles tenían de por sí ya una condición social más elevada. Esta cuestión a Drake, evidentemente, en la construcción psicológica de Drake como personaje, le tiene que haber afectado mucho. El sentirse que él era menos que Doughty y otros caballeros, seguramente en la conciencia de Drake pesaba muchísimo. De modo tal que Drake tiene que marcar un límite porque sabe que si la situación continúa así va a terminar perdiendo la autoridad sobre el manejo de la flota.
So will ich vor Gott Zeugnis ablegen, dass dieser Mann, einstiger Vertrauter und Wegbegleiter, sich nun als Verschwörer, als Aufwiegler und durchwegs verdorbener Charakter erwiesen hat. Master Doughty! Master Doughty! Habt ihr vor, zu eurer Verteidigung das Wort zu ergreifen?
Master Drake, ihr wisst, dass all eure Anschuldigungen nichts als üble Verleumdungen sind. Ich erwarte, dass sie mich zurück nach England bringen, damit dort nach den Gesetzen ihrer Majestät über diese unsäglichen Vorwürfe geurteilt werden kann.
Es wird hier und heute ein Urteil geben. Meine Herren,
überlegt,
was für eine großartige Reise wir angetreten haben, wie sie nie zuvor von England aus gemacht worden ist. Mit diesem Unternehmen wird der Niedrigste in dieser Flotte zu einem Herrn werden. Und wenn dieses Unternehmen nicht ein Erfolg werden sollte, wofür ich keine Möglichkeit sehe, solange dieser Mensch am Leben ist, was für eine Schmach wäre es dann? Nicht nur für unser Land, sondern besonders für uns. Das möge der Einfachste hier unter uns bedenken.
Del tétrico puerto de San Julián, los marineros de Drake encontraron la horca que había levantado Magallanes 58 años antes. No solamente encontraron la horca, sino también encontraron los restos insepultos, los cadáveres de las dos personas que Magallanes había desterrado aquí en la bahía de San Julián. Este lugar, que ya de por sí tenía un halo fantasmagórico porque rondaban los fantasmas de los muertos de Magallanes, tendría un papel absolutamente crucial en el destino de la expedición de Drake. Algo importante iba a pasar acá. La vida de Drake o la vida de Doughty estaban en juego. Uno de los dos saldría perdiendo.
Deshalb, meine Herren, mögen diejenigen, die denken, dieser Mann habe den Tod verdient, mit mir die Hand erheben. So sei es.
Es ist Unrecht! Beweist mir meine Schuld! Und vor allem, beweist mir und allen hier Anwesenden, dass ihr überhaupt befugt seid, über mich zu urteilen!
Dann umarmte der Verurteilte Captain Drake, wobei er ihn seinen guten Kapitän nannte, verabschiedete sich von ihm und der ganzen Mannschaft und legte sein Haupt auf den Block. Nachdem es abgeschlagen worden war, ließ Drake es hasserfüllt emporheben, der gesamten Mannschaft zeigen und sagte: Seht, das ist das Ende von Verrätern.
Spring has come, and Drake pulls together his men and supplies. The Maria is destroyed and left behind, and the rations and crew are spread over the remaining four ships. At the end of August 1577, Drake reaches the Magellan Strait. At the time, it was the only known route through to the Pacific. To the south of the strait, the geographers of the epoch believed there was a great continent shrouded in myth, known as Terra Australis. The Magellan Strait was thought to pass along its northern coast to the Pacific. It takes Drake 3 weeks to navigate through the perilous passage. As the vast waters of the Pacific stretch out before them, the captain and his crew breathe a sigh of relief. Little do they know, the most dangerous part of the expedition is about to befall them.
Am 7. September, dem zweiten Tage nach unserer Einfahrt in den Pazifik, der von manchen das friedliche Meer genannt wird, uns gegenüber sich aber als das wütende Meer zeigte, schien Gott sich durch einen widrigen Wind und einen unerträglichen Sturm gegen uns zu stellen. Furchtbaren Schreie, als die Hand Gottes sie ergriff.
The storm rages for 50 days. Drake's ship is blown in all directions. One of the vessels sink, there's nothing that can be done. The contact to the last ship is cut off. Drake and the Golden Hind are stranded at sea. Much further south than Drake would ever have dared sail. Drake's only option is to follow the storm. To remain near the coast and its dangerous rocks would be suicide. After the storm has pulled the ship out to the Antarctic Ocean, they're steadily dragged southeast. Through sheer coincidence, Drake makes a surprising discovery. Cape Horn. The geographers were wrong. There is no mysterious southern continent between the Atlantic and the Pacific. It's possible to sail around South America on open seas. The Magellan Strait is not the only access route to the Pacific. To this day, the southern tip of America has lost none of its savagery.
Sí, en realidad siempre es emocionante volar sobre lugares que muy pocas personas tienen la accesibilidad. Volar sobre el Cabo de Hornos, pensar que es lo último ya de tierra firme que hay por espacio de 1,000 kilómetros aproximadamente hasta llegar a la península Antártica nuevamente, es emocionante.
Experts are uncertain exactly where Drake went ashore, but a sketch made by Reverend Fletcher bears striking resemblance to this landscape. Fletcher's sketches and the existence of Cape Horn is kept a closely guarded secret by the English. The Spaniards have no knowledge of this tip of land where the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans join. Spain is the enemy and is welcome to continue navigating the treacherous Magellan Strait. It creates a great tactical advantage for England as they can now approach Spanish ships in the Pacific undetected. Finally, Drake can start heading for his actual goal, the Spanish treasures of gold and silver that have been looted and mined from the South Americas. Unimaginable quantities are transported over the land bridge of Panama and then shipped to Spain. No foreign power has ever disturbed Spain in the Pacific. The Spaniards feel so safe that they do not even employ guard ships to protect their spoils. Drake's main strength is the element of surprise. With skill and courage, he begins to attack the powerful Spanish kingdom at its Achilles heel. Drake plunders his way up the western coastline, ransacking the Spanish ships and port towns one after the other. Gallows or the pyre await any Protestant prisoner of Catholic Spain. The Spaniards that were captured by Drake lived to tell the tale.
A lot of the information we have on Drake's character actually comes from Spanish prisoners. Now, Drake was a smart guy. He knew that if he captured a ship and let the crew live and treated them well, once he let these guys go, they were going to be set to the Inquisition. They were going to be questioned about what happened. They wanted to know everything about Francis Drake.
Er unterhielt sich mit mir, bis es Zeit war für das Abendessen. Ich sollte mich neben ihn setzen und er bediente mich von seinem Teller. Ich solle mich nicht grämen. Mein Leben und mein persönlicher Besitz seien sicher.
Er ist gut zu uns gewesen, außer dass wir während der Fastenzeit Fleisch essen mussten. Weil sie sind Lutheraner und gaben uns von ihrem Essen.
Da ließ er uns frei und gab uns das Schiff zurück. Allerdings ließ er das Hauptsegel und den Anker ins Meer werfen. Er wusste, dass wir ein schnelles Schiff hatten und wollte verhindern, dass wir andere waren.
Es dauerte 3 ganze Tage, bis sie die ganzen Silberbarren von unserem Schiff auf das ihre verladen haben. Außerdem nahmen sie Mehl, Zucker, gesalzenes Fleisch und vieles andere. Aber er tötete niemanden.
By treating them well, by looking after them, by being a gentleman, he was able to put out word that if Francis Drake captured you, you weren't going to necessarily struggle so much. It was going to be okay, and then he was going to let you go. When word got out about that, it made it a lot easier for Drake to capture ships at sea and take ports, because knowing this, they would surrender much more easily, looking for a lot less bloodshed.
Drake knows that he's playing a dangerous game. The Spanish court is swiftly informed of his antics.
Der englische Pirat weiß, dass all die Orte, an denen er bisher vorbeikam, inzwischen alarmiert und bewaffnet sind. Ihm ist bewusst, dass ihn ab jetzt alle Schiffe in Peru und Chile jagen werden.
Undeterred, Drake continues to plunder his way through Central America. His main problem is how to safely transport his spoils home. Now begins a part of the journey that has served for much disagreement amongst the experts.
Master Lee, glaubt ihr, dass Drake versuchen wird, die Nordwestpassage zu finden?
Sir, es wäre der schnellste Weg zurück. Und weit entfernt von den portugiesischen und spanischen Schiffen. Und wir haben selbst hier gemeinsam mit ihm gestanden und die Karten studiert.
Und Frobisch hat schon bewiesen, dass man von Osten her in die Passage einfahren kann.
Ja, die tatsächliche Einfahrt von Westen könnte viel südlicher liegen.
Ach, könnte. Wird er. Nichts wissen wir. Nichts können wir tun. Wir können nur für ihn beten.
If Drake found the Northwest Passage, it would guarantee a safe and speedy return to England. Such a seaway would be an invaluable geostrategic advantage. English traders would have a direct route to Asia without having to cross the Spanish or the Portuguese.
Well, the 16th century was a period of struggle between nations, between religions, between economic systems. And Drake was one of the leaders in the English side, which wanted to go out into the oceans, establish trade routes, and try to break down the overwhelming power of Spain, which threatened their religion, it threatened their way of life, it threatened their queen. So this was simply a method, an informal method, a Cold War method of weakening Spain. If they could find a route around North America to get into the Pacific, all the better.
To this day, historians disagree how far north Drake came, and whether finding the Northwest Passage was even a part of his mission. The only certainty is that Drake was the first European to sail this far north.
Die Kälte wurde so stark, dass sich unter unseren Männern, obwohl Seeleute doch einen großen Appetit haben, die Frage erhob, ob sie ihre Hände dazu verwenden sollten, ihren Hunger zu stillen oder sie lieber in den wärmenden Umhüllungen zu lassen, um sich vor der schneidenden Kälte zu schützen.
Drake had to abandon his search for the passage. This meant his route would certainly take the fleet through Spanish waters. This also made lands discovered by Drake in the west less attractive to the British crown. Too far off to be of use, the English would migrate into America from the east, from New England. Before Drake starts the journey home across the Pacific, he finds a safe place to anchor the ship and make preparations and provisions for the long journey. Strong winds blow him southwards along the coast.
Well, the open water out here where we are right now, there's absolutely no protection whatsoever. Especially with the northwest like we have right now. Just that sometimes it'll get so rough out here that we just cannot be out here. And any safe haven we can find is a blessing. And Drake's Bay is about the best one on the north coast. Once we do get inside the bay there around Chimney Rock, it will be flat calm in there because it's totally protected from anything that's coming from the northwest.
The White Cliffs are a clue that this is where Drake anchored. Francis Fletcher writes, "Our captain named the country Nora Albion. Firstly, because of its white cliffs and white beaches. Secondly, because it reminded him of our homeland, which once carried the same name."
Drake came round the headland, then into the bay, into the channel, hooked around here and into this small cove.
But how safe are Drake and his men from the Spaniards?
The last raid against the Spaniards was in southernmost Mexico, which is several thousand kilometers away. Once Drake left there, the Spaniards would have no way of knowing which direction he had gone, and there would have been no way to trace him. Now, he did build a little fort down here. He wanted to be sure he could protect himself if the Spaniards came, but the chances of their finding him were practically non-existent.
Drake remains cautious. They are vulnerable when the ship is beached and the cargo has been unloaded, but a necessity if the ship is to undergo much-needed repairs.
Sir! Sir! Master Drake! Sit!
Niemand wird diesen Menschen auch nur ein Haar krümmen. Runter mit den Waffen. Bringt die Kiste mit den Stoffen.
It is a historic moment. The first time that Indians and Europeans come face to face on the west coast of America.
Die Männer gehen meistenteils nackt. Die Frauen nehmen eine Art von Binsen, bearbeiten sie wie Hanf und machen sich daraus ein lockeres Gewand, das an der Taille eng anliegt und bis über die Hüften reicht und es ihnen somit ermöglicht, das zu bedecken, was nach den Geboten der Natur verhüllt werden sollte. Nachdem sie uns zur Genüge besucht und gesehen hatten, begaben sie sich erfreut wieder zu ihren Häusern zurück. Diese Häuser sind rund und in die Erde eingegraben. Vom oberen Rand der ausgehobenen Erde aus sind ringsherum Pfähle aufgestellt, die an ihrem oberen Ende zusammenlaufen, ähnlich den Turmspitzen unserer Kirchtürme. Diese Überdachungen sind mit Erde bedeckt, lassen kein Wasser durch und sind sehr warm.
Fletcher's descriptions are very detailed and a further clue that Drake came ashore in this bay. For this was the only place that the coastal Miwok have ever called their home.
Imagine what the native people must have thought when they looked out on the ocean and saw these ships coming in, a colorful ship, coming from the area that they knew that where the dead went. And here were people coming in a ship with rigging and scrambling up and down the rigging, and they had to make an adjustment in their own lives. What was this phenomenon? And it was, could only have been to them, the dead were returning. And just the opposite from that, the British saw all this attention and the awe and the shock and the fear and believed that they were being seen as gods.
Physical evidence of Drake landing on the Marin shore, which we know he did and camped for 6 weeks before he sailed across the Pacific, is scanty. And the reason for that is they didn't leave much behind that could remain. Most of it was organic material, so that those kinds of things don't really last through four centuries. So one of the fascinating things we have in our collection of porcelains, which were excavated from the 16 Native American sites on Drake's Bay, are some of these pieces that were worked by the Native Americans in their traditional way. So they may have flaked obsidian, so they took the porcelain plates and chose certain parts of the patterns and designs and flaked them as well. Some were found near burials, and some were concentrated in other areas of their village site that seemed to give them some prominence in the Native American world after Drake left.
One and a half years before, Drake had set out from Plymouth. Now he's coming home. He has to sail west across the Pacific. The Spaniards are waiting for him along the western coast of America, and the Northwest Passage remains hidden. Francis Drake is well prepared for this crossing, better than Magellan, who lost many crew to malnourishment. Thanks to the accurate Spanish maps, Drake knows the best course to steer through the Pacific. He knows how long the crossing will take and has ensured there are enough provisions. For 68 days, the fleet sails across the ocean with no land in sight. The route leads through waters controlled by the Portuguese. The rivals of the Spanish have had control over the lucrative trade from the Spice Islands for generations. With it comes great wealth and power. The battle for the spices plays out bloodily on the idyllic islands time and time again between the Spanish, Portuguese, and Arab world. The local rulers are used as puppets as the foreign powers pursue their interests away from home. Barbula, the Sultan of Ternate, greets Drake with great eagerness. What are his expectations?
Sultan Barbula, supaya Drake ini bisa membantu kepada Sultan Barbula untuk mengusir kaum penjajah, terutama Portugis yang ada di bumi Nusantara. Karena asumsi Sultan Barbula bahwa di Nusantara ini kalau masih ada Portugis, maka tidak akan aman di seluruh Indonesia ini, karena ambisi politik terlalu kuat.
Drake has the sense to not involve himself in local conflicts, a mistake that Magellan made 50 years earlier and paid for with his life. He does what he can to open up trade between the precious Spice Islands and the British Crown. He's already made enemies with the Spanish. Now he risks doing the same with the Portuguese by negotiating a trade agreement with the Sultan of Ternate. But on land, Drake exercises restraint. He settles for a proclamation of solidarity and promises military support in the future.
Tujuan utama Drake adalah mencari rempah-rempah. Memang ternyata di dalam kapal itu ada beberapa kilogram cengkeh. Bahkan Sultan Barbula sendiri berjanji bahwa bila permintaan itu disanggupi, dalam hal ini adalah kerjasama politik tadi, maka Sultan Barbula akan menerapkan sistem politik ekonomi monopoli terhadap Drake untuk memenuhi permintaan apapun yang diinginkan, terutama adalah cengkeh.
Drake also loads the ships with 6 more tons of the valuable spices. In early November 1579, a heavily laden Golden Hind starts to make its way home.
Wir fuhren unter voller Besegelung, als plötzlich, als wir es am wenigsten erwarteten, ohne jedes Vorzeichen einer Gefahr, mit dem Beginn der ersten Nachtwache unser Schiff hart auf ein Riff auflief, das wie aus dem Nichts auftauchte. Eine ausweglose Situation. Und unsere Seelen schienen endgültig verloren zu sein.
Is this the end of the journey? Will the hopes for an English circumnavigation of the globe be buried here? Will Drake's discoveries, his sketches and maps, be forever lost in the depths of the Indian Ocean?
Sir, wir können keinen Grund orten. Der verdammte Felsen scheint direkt aus der Hölle zu kommen.
Wir müssen Grund finden, um uns am Anker von den Felsen runterzuziehen. Versucht es weiter.
Aye, aye, Sir.
Sir, das Schiff ist weggeschlagen.
Wie schlimm ist es? Könnt ihr dagegen antrunken?
Die Männer sind schon dabei, Sir. Ich glaube, wir können noch ein paar Stunden durchhalten. Aber wenn sich das Schiff bei dem Seegang weiter bewegt.
Männer! Wir müssen das Schiff leichter machen. Wir werden hier nur lebend rauskommen, wenn wir ballastlos werden.
Es ist die Strafe Gottes, alles geraubte Gold und Silber, Master Doughty. Es war Unrecht und jetzt müssen wir dafür bezahlen.
Schweigt man Gottes. Packt lieber mit an, wenn wir hier lebend rauskommen wollen.
Nachdem klar war, dass man keinen Grund erreichen konnte, haben wir 8 Kanonen, die Hälfte der Gewürze und des Pfeffers und die Ballen an Stoffen einfach über Bord geworfen. Dann knieten alle nieder und beteten zu Gott, uns zu erretten. Und es gefiel ihm, nachdem wir das Schiff auf diese Weise erleichtert hatten, das Schiff zu befreien, nachdem es 20 Stunden am Felsen festgesessen hatte.
Los, los, los.
It will be another 6 months before they sail into Plymouth Harbor in the autumn of 1580. Almost 3 years since they first set sail. Will Drake return as a celebrated hero, or will Elizabeth be forced to sacrifice him to appease Spain? Will he be acknowledged as the discoverer of new lands, or be hanged as the dreaded pirate? Will he be held to account for Doughty's death? King Philip II of Spain is incensed when he learns that Drake has returned with ships laden with Spanish gold. His diplomat requests an audience with the Queen.
Drake ist ein Pirat, der an den Galgen gehört.
Genug! Botschafter, mäßigt euch in eurem Ton.
Majestät, bei allem Respekt. Aber König Philipp wird darauf bestehen, dass dieser Plünderer bestraft und das gestohlene Diebesgut bis auf den letzten Peso zurückgezahlt wird.
Das liegt wohl nicht in seiner Gewalt. Ihr dürft euch zurückziehen.
Elizabeth remains unimpressed by the threats of war from Spain. She neither compensates Spain, nor does she put Drake in front of a judge for the murder of Thomas Doughty. Whilst the ambassador is stalled, a plan is hatched to bring the treasures to shore in secret. The loot is to be taken to a safe and deserted stretch of land off the west coast of England.
Drake brought so much treasure back from his venture that it took the mules days to bring it up from the Golden Hind to here at Tremerton Castle. Everybody from the venture got incredibly rich. Even the cabin boys were the equivalent of modern-day millionaires. The finances and backers became very wealthy, and the Queen was able to pay off the national foreign debt and fund future projects. But because of the Spanish threat, the amount that was brought back had to be shrouded in secrecy. So only Drake really knows how much was here at Tremerton.
It's assumed that a large part of the treasure was shared out under the table before the remainder was taken to the Tower of London under heavy guard. The official inventory states 20 tons of gold and silver, with a neat receipt signed by Drake himself. More valuable than all the gold were Drake's logbook, his sketches, and his maps. These also documented the appropriation of new lands for Her Majesty the Queen. But to this day, the closely guarded documents remain unfound. The gold from South America enables a British fleet to be built and manned. 8 years after Drake's circumnavigation, Elizabeth can successfully defend her country against the attack of the Spanish Armada. Drake is Vice Admiral in the historic battle. Elizabeth remains on the throne, and England remains Protestant. It is the beginning of the end of Spain's domination of the seas.
The English establishment realized that there was money to be made abroad. So investors got together, and in 1600, they established the East India Company, which eventually traded internationally. And all that trade and money passed through the East India Company headquarters in central London, the City of London, which established the City of London as the financial center of the world that we know today. So that's really Drake's main legacy.
Drake becomes a national hero. His initial investment in the adventurous trading voyage has paid off. He is one of the richest men in England. But the call of the sea does not leave him. 15 years later, Drake dies of dysentery on a voyage plundering the Caribbean.